So that game happened. Alright, folks. So, Patriots, Falcons, the Super Bowl rematch. Boy, was this kind of a letdown, you know? You know, they kind of built this game to be, you know, one of the, obviously, prestige games of the NFL season. And, wasn't totally a blowout. Let's say, yeah, it kind of was a blowout. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Then again, so was this week in the NFL. Like, this was probably the most dull week in the NFL. You know, you had no NFL protests. You had, what else did you have? And I mean protests, I mean kneeling. You had the final scores. Bucket, you had several shutouts, a.k.a. blowouts as well. So, yeah, that wasn't necessarily fun. But, hey, hopefully the Monday night game tomorrow should be good. You know, the Washington team, because if I say their actual name, be politically, and people are going, oh, you're a racist for saying their name, even though it's been their name forever. And while I do agree that that name is kind of racist, it's been going on for Lord knows how many decades, so there's that. And, of course, the Philadelphia Eagles. And, by the way, shout-out to EDP for once again picking against the Patriots, and the Patriots won. So, how you feel about that? Probably jumping on top of your bed. Ugh, don't want to picture that. So, back to this game. 23-7. The Patriots did win this one. Not a terrible game by the Patriots. They actually, yes, you're probably thinking, wait a minute. 23-7? The Patriots only allowed 7 points. This same Patriots team allowed more points to the New York Jets. J-E-T-S. Who continue to, like, not know how to tank, even though they did lose today. They allowed more points against the Jets than the Falcons. You know, the Falcons with, you know, Tevin Coleman, Devontae Freeman, Matt Ryan, Julio Jones, Mohamed Sanu. You know, you get the idea. And, you know, I will admit, it's kind of, and people are going to go, oh, is it because of the Falcons' offense struggling, or is it the Patriots' defense coming together? For me personally, I think it's both. The Falcons, to be fair, should be, despite being 3-3 right now, you can make an argument this team should be 1-5. Like, this team defensively is, they're not terrible, but they're not necessarily that good either. And offensively, they're just not getting it together. I don't understand. Because, again, you have plenty of talent on the offensive side of the football. How can you not move the field, move the ball up down the field? And the thing is, too, the Falcons, I believe, went to the red zone about 4 times in this game. They only scored 1 touchdown. Now, to be fair, the Patriots usually do well. In red zone defense-wise, they're usually one of the stronger teams in the last several years. It's a trend, it's a pattern. But, you know, you look at the Matt Ryan and the Falcons, 23 for 33, 233 and a touchdown. Oh, by the way, hashtag Foggate. Because apparently it's a conspiracy. You know, some people are... I know it's mostly jokes. But, oh, the Patriots made fog in Gillette Stadium. Like, yes, Bill Belichick got the biggest fog machine you could get, put in the middle of Gillette Stadium and said, blow away. So, Devontae Freeman, decent game for him, 12 for 72. I don't know why they didn't run the ball more. I get they were down, but 12 rushes for 72 yards, that's not necessarily all that bad. But, anywho, Julio Jones, good game from him, 9 receptions, 99 yards, including a touchdown, which to me, that touchdown kind of looked like an offensive PI, but it is what it is. Then everybody else, I mean, Malcolm Butler, I think overall, covering Julio Jones, did a decent job. Again, the Patriots had no Stephon Gilmore in this game. They had no Eric Rowe, so it was just like McCourty and Butler. And then you started getting bad when you had like Patrick Chung in there, and it was like, ugh. God, I hate Patrick Chung. Why is he still in the NFL? But anywho, props to those guys, especially McCourty. McCourty did a really good job covering Sanu, and at times Gabriel. Same with, believe it or not, Patrick Chung. So, you know, props to them for that one. And the Patriots did block a field goal. Matt Bryant field goal. Yes, Matt Bryant, 0 for 2 for field goals in this one. Young Hoku says hi. No, seriously, though. But again, with the Falcons, they got to Brady, I believe it was about four or five times. Brady was sacked four times in this game, like three or four. So still Brady's getting pressure, but it's not as dramatic as like the first two games where it's like, oh, he's been sacked like nine times. You know what I'm saying? So that was that with the Falcons. And then you go on the Patriots, 21 for 29, for Tom Brady. 249 yards, a couple touchdowns. Deion Lewis led the backfield with 13 carries for 76 yards, including a 25-long gainer. And that was pretty much it for the running game. Mike Gillisley, pretty quiet. Rex Burkhead, yes, Rex Burkhead is alive, guys. He's back in the lineup. He's back in, you know, healthy and good to go. 6 carries for 31 yards. And that was pretty much it. I mean, let's count James White, 4 for 19. But Chris Hogan, brother, again, no touchdown for Chris Hogan. But a better game this one than he did last week. 4 receptions, 71 yards. Brandon Cooks had a touchdown, 4 receptions, 65 yards, pardon me. And Gronk had 3 receptions, 51 yards. He would have had more yards had he not get called for offensive pass interference, which reminds me, how are we in, like, the top 5 and offensive pass interferences? Someone explain this to me. I'm dying to know. That was not offensive pass interference by Rob Gronkowski, by the way. That was such a BS call, but anywho. And James White had the other touchdown, so both Cooks and White each had respective touchdowns by Mr. Tom Brady. And Gronkowski, perfect 3 for 3. Yeah. Not much to say. And see, did anybody else get a sack on this one? Got Butler. Not Malcolm Butler, the other Butler. Is it Adam Butler? Anyone? Anywho. Point is, not really. You're probably thinking, man, Chris, you're not really enthusiastic in this game because this game wasn't very enthusiastic. the best part of this game was the fog. Because if you just look back and you're like, you're seeing this big white screen, and you're like, why? I mean, I know someone who's originally from Massachusetts, weather can get that bad, but dang, that's insane. But yeah, so that's it. That's it pretty much. Patriots win this one again, 23-7. Patriots improved to 5-2. Yeah, I remember when the sky is falling, the sky is falling. Yeah, the Patriots have won like 3 straight games. So. And they host next week against the Los Angeles Chargers, who blew out the Denver Broncos 21-0, and that was a boring game. I was watching that while cleaning my house. Boring. Cleaning my house was far more entertaining than watching that game, put it that way. And of course, the Chargers, the Chargers have plenty of weapons on offense. And that's the thing, when people are like, oh, the Chargers are rebuilding. How are they rebuilding with that many talented targets on their team? You know, Hunter Henry is a good young tight end. Of course, old man Antonio Gates. Keenan Allen, the injury-prone Keenan Allen, which I believe he hasn't been out. He's been banged up. I know he was questionable entering earlier today's game against the Broncos, but he was good to go. Melvin Gordon could be good, but I noticed Melvin Gordon could be inconsistent at times. Of course, he also got Travis Benjamin, who had a big game this past week, you know, earlier today. And who else was there? I'm forgetting some. Oh, Tyrell Williams, he's okay. And Mike Williams, who hasn't really done anything. I know he's just recently come back from being banged up, but yeah, I wouldn't be surprised down the road, maybe the Chargers. If I was them, I'd trade, honestly, Keenan Allen for a high draft pick, and then, hey, Mike Williams, here's your spot type of deal. Unless they wanted to, Keenan Allen, Mike Williams, I understand. Maybe, you know, push Benjamin to the side because he's a bit older of the you know, trio, I guess you want to say, of the receiving core. But point is, the Chargers, this offensive line better be ready for the Chargers. Because whenever you have Joey Bosa and you have Melvin Ingram, you're going to be pressured. So, by the way, this is only the second win of the Patriots at home in, you know, this upcoming game next Sunday. Halloween Eve. What is it wrong with me? Am I like high? No, I'm not. The 29th of, obviously, next week, Patriots host the Chargers. Patriots should win that one. But, you know, that's another thing, too, by the way. I almost forgot. Goodness. Matt Ryan only threw for 233 yards against this defense. Everybody else threw like 300 plus. 350, 370, close to 400, 350, 330, 320. You get the idea. Matt Ryan, as talented of a quarterback he is, and again, he's kind of struggled this year, but still, 233 yards against Matt Ryan. Very good by this defense. This defense is finally coming back together. It's far from perfect. I said on Twitter, this defense is far from perfect, but it's making improvements. And when you have this offense rolling as it is, and this defense is slowly improving, they're all of a sudden now finally starting to become, you know, one of the biggest threats in the NFL. In which you see a bunch of these teams, a lot of them are mediocre. Yeah, I'm not saying all of them, of course. That's dramatic and not true, to be fair. But, you know, there's not really an elite team right now in the NFL that makes any sense. I mean, Kansas City's lost back-to-back. You know, they're starting to look like a pulling the Minnesota Vikings from last year, where it's like, oh, yeah, Super Bowl favorites. And then next thing you know, now they're going to make that dramatic. Which, by the way, the AFC West all of a sudden is wide open. That's what she said. No, but seriously, though, the AFC West, like, anyone can win it. At the Raiders, it would seem like they're waking up from a coma. The Chiefs are who else is in there? The Broncos, they can't score to save their lives. Like, their defense is okay, but it's not as good as what they thought. And, like, Trevor Siemian, once again, is an average quarterback. I've said this to, like, people a billion times, but it was like, oh, no, he's a really good quarterback. And then now you have the Chargers all of a sudden winning three straight games. And which, to be fair, they should be, like, what, 5-2 right now if it wasn't for, you know, the great Charger. Young Hoo Koo said nobody ever. But, yeah, so even though you probably look at the Chargers' record right now, you're probably thinking, oh, well, they're 3-4, not that good. And, you know, they're not perfect by any stretch. They do have their holes, obviously, special teams. It seems like the Chargers, they always seem to have problems with special teams. I don't know why. But, yeah, obviously, they do have a better kicker now. That's an improvement. And their defense, if you block well, you can do well against this team. They do have holes, especially in the secondary and the corner position. And the defensive backs, obviously. So, don't be surprised if Bray just chucks it to Brandon Cooks. If you're Brandon Cooks in fantasy, start him next week. Alright? So, but obviously the big test with Patriots is how they're going to contend Joey Bosa and Melvin Ingram on the left and the right-hand side. So, otherwise, that's about it. So, that's it for me, as I just said. Yeah, should be an interesting week. Patriots prepare for the Chargers. Go Chargers, go. I swear, people still call them San Diego, even though they're in L.A., but technically they're in Carson, and, like, by the way, shout-out to Bronco fans who showed up to the game, because, like, 75% of that crowd were Bronco fans, a bunch of orange, anyways, and I'm out.